Hello everyone, how are you? I'm Ari Thierger and today I'm going to make the book review for Werewolf Magic, Authentic Practical Lycanthropy by Danny Sargent. I wasn't going to make a book review on this one actually, but when I bought this book, I have shown it on my Instagram, asking those who follow me on that platform if they had read it already and what was their opinion about the book. So a lot of people were curious and wanted me to make a book review. So that's why I'm making this video. First, let me apologize to the author of this book because this isn't going to be a very positive review, but I don't think it will be that bad either. So, sorry. Now, I hope this doesn't prevent people from getting it anyway, because one thing are the reviews that greatly change from person to person, their own perspectives when they read such books. Another thing is your own experience when you get in touch with something, and surely your perspective will be a little bit different from the reviews. This isn't one of the worst books I've ever read, not in the slightest, but I was very disappointed with it. Still, in the past I have made reviews of books which I very much wanted to throw them into the garbage bin, but this isn't one of those. But this is the sort of book, in my opinion, to read only once. I have enjoyed it, and now it goes into the shelf somewhere down below probably, and I won't pick it again. If you haven't read or heard anything or any review concerning this book, if you have no knowledge of it whatsoever, my advice to you is that whatever you think about this book, whatever you think this will be about, it isn't. Don't expect anything, really, and you won't be disappointed. Because part of the reason why I didn't enjoy this book is precisely because I expected it to be something else. I expected it to delve a little bit further into cultic and ceremonial practices involving wolf and werewolf cults based on evidences. It's hard enough to find something like that, obviously, but not impossible. We just have to delve really deep into not only in historical accounts and reports and records, but also anthropological studies and archaeology and interpretation of contexts. But for that, we also have to be aware of a variety of werewolf and wolf cults all over the world. Be aware of mythologies, foundations of certain cultures, the cultural background of a variety of peoples, and immerse ourselves into the various scientific works on the field of social human sciences. Well, this book isn't at all about that. This is a New Age approach, a personal approach from the part of the author, I would say very much influenced by Neo-Druidism and the Gardnerian Wicca, or so it seems, but of course with a specific interpretation and of course a personal approach and activity. Even though it's not really historically related, nor scientific, not even in relation to psychology or the attempt to reconstruct something out of evidences, I am not 100% disappointed, because I do find it very curious, and I do like to know what people are up to, what are their personal approaches, what are they doing in their private lives concerning witchcraft, esoteric work, spirituality, the occult. Well, not so private anymore, since it's in a book, it's for everyone to read it. But on that account, I have enjoyed it because it makes me happy to see that humanity is finally picking up the pace again and returning and rediscovering magic. It gives me pleasure and it puts a smile on my face to see that a certain freedom is slowly being built and people are exploring as best as they can and in their own ways, and trying to reach out again. Still, humanity still has a long way to go, as there was a huge break, unfortunately, which in spiritual terms has thrown us back into ignorance, uncertainty, and fear. But I'm happy to see each one is trying their best and are pretty open to it and about it and about their practices. And this is being allowed, actually, in our modern days, and we can all exchange ideas. So if anything, this book might open up the curiosity in some people so they can try it for themselves and from there developing their own approaches. Now, the author starts the book with a few pages speaking about the history of werewolf cults. As I've said, it's not an historical book, so it's really just a few pages in general terms speaking about a variety of cultures, just to form a sort of bridge to the rest of the book and show evidences that this has been done for a very long time. The first 20 pages made me want to put the book aside, I confess. But I kept going anyway, obviously. In terms of the history of werewolves in witchcraft, or in the witchcraft panorama, the author could have picked the examples from Estonian, Lithuanian, and other examples from, for instance, from the Baltic regions, but sadly there's no mention of it whatsoever. When it comes to the Old Norse historical contexts, the author could have picked half a dozen accounts where we clearly see the idea of the werewolf figure in the north and the importance of the wolf motif, but the author preferred to speak a little bit about the concepts of Hamr and the Filia and the idea of shape-shifting, which in my opinion was a mistake for this sort of book and the message the author wants to pass on, because those are very complex concepts. I've been speaking about those in this channel and I have at least 50 hours of videos just to speak and really delve into those subjects, into these concepts. So obviously just two pages on that, it won't cover anything, and in reality it will just express misinformation. The author further ahead, of course, speaks about the fetches, the familiar spirits, an idea very much present and expressed in the conceptions of the Old Norse philia and hamre and shape-shifting. But it's quite the misguided approach, in my opinion, from the part of the author. There's this tendency to speak of the fetch as an alter ego of the person, and this not only... This isn't only a misinterpretation of the sources, but also a lack of understanding of a more animistic approach, which would have been quite useful since the author is talking about the idea of the werewolf magic, an animal. Sometimes it feels the author wants to have a more animistic approach to the subject, but then there's a complete cut on what seems to have been the steps going on that direction. But after all, there's a complete different turn. There's also there are more pages on Roman cultural context with some pretty interesting ideas, actually. But this also bothered me a little bit, because when we speak about werewolves and Rome and Romans, the Roman culture, there's always the tendency to speak about the founders of Rome, Romulus and Remus, and having been nurtured by a she-wolf, precisely. And this comes in this book as evidences for wolf cults in Roman cultural background. So there's this idea that the foundations of Rome have a link or some sort of connection to werewolf cults or wolf cults in general, which just isn't true at all. That's just trying to find a connection to something that simply isn't there. A common mistake, obviously, based on misinterpretations and misunderstandings of Roman history and the Roman mentality. So, if you allow me, let me just take the opportunity to clarify this in just a few words, really just a few words, very, very quickly. Romulus and Remus are nicknames for these two characters to express real events and the origins of part of the foundations of Rome, and the origins of part of the culture. Romulus is related to the idea of force, by force, or forcibly doing something, also related to military tactics and the violent process of taking something or someone by force. Remus, on the other hand, is related to water, paddling, and the paddle, and navigating. So these two characters express an early invasion from peoples across the sea outside the Italian peninsula, and real conflicts and exchange of cultures and clash of cultures and cultural syncretism. The she-wolf, on the other hand, is called lupa, a she-wolf, but not literally an animal, not literally a she-wolf that wasn't nurturing the two brothers. Lupa, or she-wolf, was the nickname or label the Romans gave to prostitutes because they were on the streets attacking and on the prowl. So the entire perspective on prostitution in the ancient world isn't obviously the same as we have nowadays in most modern countries. The idea of the lupa, the she-wolf, which is a prostitute, is to show that the foundations of Rome also come from a humble background. To show that it isn't a question of pure bloodline or hereditary power or having any right to the throne or to rule or any right to power, but to show and to never forget its humble origins, right? That's the main idea here. When we deal with mythologies, we do need to not only understand the history behind it, but we need to understand the mentality of the culture and of the people. As I said many times before, and this goes again as an advice to anyone who studies mythologies, mythologies are not pure fantasy. They are not explanations for when something is too hard to explain or to understand, and so let us just put a giant in here with three heads spitting fire and lightning bolts from its eyes. But mythology is a cultural code. It demonstrates real events and the mentality of a people, history, various conceptions, art, ways of life, and so on and so forth. Mythology is created precisely when there is no other way to record events or other than oral tradition. So myths are created to better interiorize and remember history and to link events easily, especially the cultural background of a people, and mythology contains the origins and essence of a culture. Which is why then we have these common mistakes and taking words at face value without really delving into the cultural background. But enough of that. This is a book review and not a history lesson, for goodness sake. And indeed, the author of this book isn't at all interested in historical evidences, but just about 20 pages to create some background, right? It was a special effort to continue to read the book because only after 100 pages or so the author really starts to delve into something more practical, which I must say, it's all extremely vague in terms of ritual, ceremony, and practice as a whole. I really think the author could have given a lot more attention to explanation between rituals and practice, but it is all presented very loosely, like scattered pieces. The author did not bother to make any connection at all, so we can better understand his own approach. After all, he is passing on to us his activities, so no clear line of thought. In terms of writing, it's not bad, actually, and I found the author's approach actually really down to earth to a certain extent. There's no great flourishing of ideas, nor an attempt to turn it into something cryptic. The author is quite open to what he is doing. The author specifically says at the very beginning of this book that he's not a shaman, which is refreshing, actually, because nowadays, as you know it, on a variety of social media networks, it's absolutely populated with shamans and a variety of shamans writing books, which is just extremely disrespectful to actual spiritual leaders of a variety of native backgrounds. And there are always loads of books out there really cryptic with more fancy words than actual context, which clearly demonstrates the person knows absolutely nothing about what they are speaking about, but want to pretend they do. So this isn't a book like that, fortunately. As I said, the author is somewhat down to earth and is trying to express what he does, his approaches, So that's something quite positive. Just showing and expressing and exchanging ideas, almost like a diary of sorts. So not presumptuous or trying to create a personal fantasy to give it some credit or a special magic meaning, but quite vague in terms of the actual practical approach. As I said, a personal approach and sharing it with the world, which in certain points it's actually very sweet and endearing. But that sweetness also creates a problem because the whole book feels very childish. The entire approach feels like the author wanted to write something for children or for teenagers, a younger audience, if you take my meaning. So adults will find it really hard to take it serious because of that. There's a lot of waking your primal self and constantly speaking about your animal self and according to your animal self. So very vague, not real explanation on this primordial power or the primeval mind. No real attempt to explain instinct and basic human impulses. No actual attempt to delve further into the more animalistic or indeed animistic aspect of the human mind. So you just have to kind of trust and go with the flow of your animal self, which could be anything or nothing at all. But I think I get the point. I think I get the idea in this book, which is to encourage people to embrace our wild side and, if need be, to actually express something a little bit more feral at times. It's okay to let loose emotions that may feel harsh and violent because they typically have a negative perception nowadays in our modern societies. So I think I get the idea that it is okay to embrace the emotions and feelings that not only makes us human, but also makes us the animals that we truly are. In New Age circles, there's always been this idea very much present and expressed of being positive all the time, all white and peace garden of green gardens of roses, and trying to be positive and express positiveness all the time, which often causes a lot of harm because it makes people neglect and indeed hide their true emotions and feelings and hide how they feel, because you are not supposed to express anything but goodness and positiveness all the time, and that quickly becomes something very toxic and negative, actually. So perhaps that's the idea the author tried to express, that is not at all very well explored in this book, sadly. There's also something that bothered me, which are the incorrect interpretations and meanings of symbols. So, well, just as the triquetra and the triskel or the triskelion. But that is something that happens a lot in a variety of New Age religious manifestations, and people constantly do that. But that's not excuse, because if you are interested in symbols, you can and should study their background and their meanings, obviously, their origins. So there's really no excuse for making incorrect interpretations of symbols and spreading such wrong information. The author also has certain approaches at times towards the Greco-Roman pantheon that really misses the mark. And also very modernized versions of old Nordic ritual. As I said, the author clearly states that he is not a shaman, but for some reason there's this random visit from an Egyptian god, so I don't know what was that all about. And the author constantly speaks of Gaia, used as a name for the earth as a being, but not as Gaia, the Greco-Roman goddess. So why Gaia? Why this name? Why specifically the Greco-Roman entity to express the general idea of the earth as a living entity? He doesn't explain. At certain points you think the author is going towards a more animistic approach, as I said, but then gives these random ideas from many religious backgrounds and a lot of modernized versions of certain religions as well, and it gets very confusing. So, this is my review on this book, very quickly. By all means, get it and read it, and you take your own conclusions. But in truth, if you want to delve into werewolf mythologies or the idea of shape-shifting or historical and archaeological evidences of wolf cults and folklore traditions, of course, as well. You can always get other books that are specifically focused only on those subjects and nothing as loosely as this book. I think it's only worth it just to be aware of a personal approach, and in that way it is useful for the study of New Age spiritualities and individual approaches, and why people are doing it, why are people inclined to this right now. But also I think it will be a question of trying for yourself these exercises slash rituals, because by actively doing something you will start to be more familiar with yourself, what better works for you, and you will end up knowing what best approach you should take. Even when things seem very silly and quite childish, just try it. Take your first steps, explore, go ahead and do it, and there will always be something you learn from it. What works for one person rarely works for another, of course, which is why you need to try as many things as you can, so you can fail many times until you are successful in something. All right, my dear friends, I hope you have enjoyed this video and this very quick book review, because I'm in a bit of a hurry, as you might have guessed. Anyway, I hope it was useful. And if you want to do werewolf magic or become a werewolf, perhaps you want to first try to grow a beard or body hair. And this goes for women as well. Just go completely feral and wild and go out there into the forest. So, that's it. I hope you have enjoyed it. Thank you so much for watching. See you on the next video. And as always, thank you for today.